Piotr Bojanowski. He works at the Facebook AI Research Lab in Paris as a research scientist. Before that, he was a postdoc at Facebook Research, and he did his PhD in area. Actually, he was born in Poland, but spent most of his time in Paris. Today he's going to talk about unsupervised approach in unsupervised methods, yes. And of course, we design.
Action recognition in video is given a video clip, a short video, you're to say what action is performed inside. So the typical data set that I was working with had actions such as sitting down, and these are examples, sitting down, standing up, these kind of things. The problem with that is that the label, like the labeling of that, is very ambiguous. The definition of what is a cat is roughly simple. It's like the cat. While saying like when is an action occurring is much more ambiguous. So that makes manual annotation of video very, very tedious. There are some tools for that, like the, this is actually very old. There used to be a tool for annotating videos in time, such as Batlink, Viper GP, and these things were not only had a very bad user interface, because you have to navigate in time, find the beginning and the end of the action, but it was just super hard to use. And the inherent problem of annotation is that the definition of the beginning and of the end was actually, is actually imprecise. When does an action begin? When does it end? I'm just going to show you an example of a video where, which was labeled by someone as eating. And you're going to say, like, is it, like, it was labeled as eating. Is it really now that eating begins? Or is it now that the plate is in front of the eater? Or is it when the guy actually picks up the burger? Or is it starting now? It's like, I mean, it's, if you're an annotator and you're supposed to annotate eating, how do you do that? It's very complicated. So I'm talking about this because I learned it the hard way. In the sense, there was this data set called Hollywood 2, which was published by my some of my supervisors from my PhD, which had a roughly 1,500 videos annotated with actions, 12 action classes. And these clips, 1,500 clips, were taken from 70 Hollywood movies. So they wanted to do Hollywood 3. Hollywood 3 would mean that we would have to annotate all the 70 movies with the 12 actions completely exhaustively. Find every time that someone is standing up in 70 movies. I was not the one doing that, but I had to do it on one movie, this one. I don't know if you've watched it. The person who was in charge of annotating said, no, I'm not gonna do it. It's a bit disturbing movie, so I had to do it. So that, the fact that it's so tedious and takes so much time kind of motivates the fact that you should work with some kind of weaker form of annotation, or with no annotation at all. So there was work in computer vision in the 2000s, which was about how to recognize people without having exact annotation. So we were modeling basically the fact that if you had a video, instead of providing precise temporal position of actions, you just say what are the things that are going to happen inside. So I'm going to give you an example. These are the results of the method. So the method was only provided the fact that there's going to be two actions, one happening after the other. So in that case, it was opening door and then sitting down. And the prediction of the algorithm was actually correct at the right moment. The algorithm had no information on the temporal position of these actions. And this is our prediction. This is the ground truth. What you see is that our predictions are all finally like end up within the ground truth, but they are much shorter than what a human annotated as the action. This is a good example. So this is labeled as hugging, and the algorithm just chose the moment when the woman is actually doing this movement. Opening door also is just the moment the guy pulls the this is, I think, the most typical example of that problem. This is labeled as eating or drinking. This is what the human annotated. This is what our algorithm predicted. And this is what the human annotated as drinking. Whereas the algorithm picked up on that. So I think it's an interesting problem and an interesting thing to work on, because this weak form of supervision may actually be closer to the data than what the variance of human annotation can provide. So, however, all this work was pre-deep learning. We used handcrafted features, dense trajectories, histograms of oriented gradients. This is really old stuff about features. The features were not learned. But we used weak form of supervision to learn a model on top of these features. And now the interesting question is whether we can use this weak form of supervision to not only train a model, but also train the representation of the model. So in this talk I will talk about two aspects of the work I've done at Facebook. One is about how to compute word vectors, how to represent words as vectors in order to be able to manipulate their meaning, with two contributions. basically the logistic loss with this feature and the given class. In the end, if you train this model on your data, the word vectors are the XWs. Then this was the skip gram model, which independently predicts the context. And also there is the SIBO model, continuous bag of word, where if I take this sentence again, given the context, you're going to try to predict the word in the name. In that case, you have an unordered set of words, and you predict one word. So you model the probability of a word given the context. You define a feature for the context, HC, a classifier for word W, and you model the probability of the word given the context, exactly as before. But this time, instead of having one vector, you have like HC, which is the feature of the context. And the feature of the context is the continuous bag of word. So it's simply the sum of the representations of the words in the context. So these are basically the two classical models that are in word2vec. And word2vec had a few drawbacks. The first one is that there are no these vectors are not sentence representations per se, because they are not trained in such a way that you could average them properly. However, averaging them is quite popular. People do that in their applications, and it works kind of okay. The second thing is that such word vectors, such as they were in word2vec, are not exploiting the morphology of the language. So words that share radicals will not share parameters. Just as an example, disastrous and disaster are going to be completely independent vectors in the model. Mangera, mangerai, which are declensions of one verb in French, will also not share any parameters. So, despite the fact that it had some drawbacks, word2vec was very simple, was very fast to train, and because of that, it was actually very widely used. So I think these are good features from the model. So we wanted to build on top of word2vec, which was simple and fast to train, while trying to exploit some word information. So we wanted a model in which grammatical variations would share most of the parameters. So I'm Polish, and in Polish you have declension. So depending on the usage of the word in a sentence, you're gonna put a different ending to the word. So for this word university, there are actually 14 different forms for just one word. It just doesn't make sense to represent each one of them as a different vector, because they all talk about the place where you come to learn. Different motivation is languages in which you have compound nouns, or agglutinative languages such as Finnish or Turkish. So in German, Tisch means a table. Tennis is just playing tennis. And Tisch tennis is playing tennis on a table, which is basically ping pong.
Table tennis.
Yeah. So in German, that's a good example of like concatenation of two words, where the meaning of the two should be added. So I think that's a good motivation to exploit morphology, and we propose to use character sequences within the words to somehow model that. So how do we exploit the subword information? We're going to represent words using the character n-graphs. So if you take this word, which means pineapple in Polish, we would represent it as all the trigrams, all the 4 grams, all the 5 grams, and all the 6 grams, and average all of them together. We add some special positional characters at the beginning and at the end of a word, and thanks to that, there is like a semantic meaning to the prefix and to the suffix. So this is the way. This is also univer is going to represent this, the prefix, and all the grammatical variations are going to be represented that way. So what is the model that we use? We exactly extend the skip gram model that I described before. Given a feature for a word, now I call it HW, the classifier for word C, you're going to model the probability of a context given word, but this time, the feature of a word is not just one which is the sum of the representation of all the substrings in the word. We actually cheat a bit and add the index of the word itself. So it's something in between. So if you use character engrams and substrings, you need to avoid using a dictionary. Because if you have a one-gram dictionary, so let's say you take the Latin alphabet, lowercase, it's going to be 26 symbols. But if you start working with UTF-8 characters, this can be quite large. K is going to be large. So if you take all the pairs of characters, it's going to be K2, which starts to be even bigger. Of course, they don't all appear, but you don't want to basically store all of that. So you need to use some hashing tricks such that you get rid of this problem. So we use, just for details, we use the folder Nonvo hash function, which has good guarantees on strings in terms of collisions. So by choosing the size of the hashing table for the, in that case, you have a kind of trade-off between not using too much memory and on the other side not having too many collisions. So there's something that needs to be tuned depending on the data that you train on. The second problem with skipgram is that you need to compute a softmax over the whole vocabulary. So if you train on Finnish, this vocabulary can be huge, so we approximate logistic multi-class loss by independent binary classifications. So if I write the label, K is the number of words, different words that you have, typical multi-class, multinomial logistic regression looks like that. So we replace something which is actually a multi-class classifier by independent one versus rest binary models. That still requires you to compute K terms to normalize. You don't normalize, but you still need to compute K terms. So in order to restrict this computation, we use negative sampling. So we're going to always consider a positive word, which was the actual word that you see in the context. And you're going to sample a few negative words instead of computing the softmax on the whole vocabulary. So the big advantage of this kind of models is that on out-of-vocabulary words, words that you haven't seen during training, we're going to be able to have a word vector. Because we computed the word vector as the sum of character engrams, and if this word was never seen in the training data, you don't have this part, but you still have that. So you can compute some kind of representation, even if the words were never seen in the training data, which is very useful in some applications with high data sparsity, such as pharmacological data, or things where you need to generalize basically on words that appear very unfrequently. Second thing is that it allows you to train on much smaller data sets because you exploit redundancy on the subword level. So how do you evaluate word embeddings? So we evaluated our method in two ways. The first one is word similarity. So given pairs of words, people have given a judgment of similarity. So here are some examples taken from the rare words dataset, where postmodernist and artist was judged as similar 6.5 out on a scale of 10, while earmuffs covering was judged 8. Winners and wallopers was only judged. images of dogs, if you're not very much into classifying dogs, maybe the best thing to do is actually maybe not pre-training on it yet. So there was a lot of interest in what it was called self-supervised learning. Most of them rely on the idea of predicting fake labels. So you define a function, a labeling function, which given the data is going to give you a label. And once you done with the unsupervised training. We were just training. We were just retraining the multi-layer perception at the end on other tasks. There are some baselines that we had when we evaluated, which was using handcrafted features. This was like the old school approach to computer vision, where you would do the sift features, do k-means on the sift features, back of visual words, or Fisher vectors. And we were comparing also to the self-supervised methods that I mentioned in the introduction. And some kind of unsupervised models, for instance, the bidirectional GAN. And when we were doing this classification on ImageNet, we have shown back then that our method was state-of-the-art, improving quite a lot on most of the methods. What was kind of surprising is that even though deep learning with supervised data was by far much better than old school computer vision, for now we were very far from the old school computer vision baseline, which was 55.6%. Now these numbers have all gone up quite a lot, as Kirchner was mentioning, stuff is moving very quickly, so like every time you publish something at the conference, there's at least like 2-3 people who do roughly the same thing, and these numbers are like going up every 3 months. If you look at the performance across the epochs, you see that training accuracy of our objective was actually still going up, so kind of overfitting the data, while the validation performance was kind of stagnating. And this test train gap is actually increasing. And one of the reasons for that was the fact that we didn't have any regularization scheme, and it's not clear how to regularize this performance. Maybe using more data was the solution. So as an effect of influence of permutations, we were not actually computing the optimal permutation every epoch, only doing that every few epochs. And you see that if you never permute, you only train the network to predict random points on the sphere, you get to that point. If you permute every epoch, you're here, and this kind of doesn't degrade much if you do it less often. So then the classical experiment is using these features on the downstream task, Pascal VOC. So you have images with bounding box, and you use the features you trained on ImageNet or in an unsupervised way as features to solve detection problems, image classification and object detection. On this evaluation, we've shown that basically we were beating the state of the art or matching it for some models. What was interesting is that I think the most important part was that if you train networks in an unsupervised way, and then you fine-tune everything, that's kind of strange. So I think the evaluation with only fine-tuning the last part of the network is the most interesting. So we were kind of competitive and comparable to the state of the art then on these tasks. Interestingly, like the performance of GAN or autoencoder-based features was quite poor on this task. So if you visualize the features, these are the typical features you obtain when you train an AlexNet on ImageNet. So we did that on the gradient filtered images in order to be comparable. And you see that the things we kind of obtained, if you close your eyes, you imagine that what you want to see, they look a bit similar. By doing nearest neighbor queries, we have these images which are queries, and you look for nearest neighbors. So here it seems correct, like the nearest neighbors were actually semantically relevant. Here seems correct again. Oh wait, no, that's not a dog. It's an ostrich, but it looks quite like a bird, like a dog, right? And here you have a bump instead of the kitchen, but there are some visual features which, again, if you close your eyes, you kind of see why this mistake could have been made. So this model was further improved later. We had an extension, like not an extension, but another way of seeing the same problem that we submitted to ECCD 2019, which was called deep clustering for unsupervised learning. membership can be used as pseudo labels, and you train your network to predict these pseudo labels. Pretty simple. So there were two losses. The first one is the clustering loss. So we experimented actually with k-means, mostly with k-means, but other clustering algorithms can be used. For instance, deep clustering, which is a graph clustering algorithm, or anything else. And so if we have a CNN which is called F, and we have n images, k-means is usually written the following way. You minimize with respect to the centroid, which are the cluster representants, the average of the minimum with respect to cluster membership of the loss between your activation and cluster membership matrix times cluster centroid matrix times cluster assignment. This is the typical loss of k-means. So we were doing that in the first step, and then doing classification. So once you solve that problem, you get the optimal assignment for each image. You can then do supervised learning and train the parameters by using the following, using the class membership here, yi, you just learn that with SGD. There is a bit of a detail, the fact that there was a linear model that we were resetting at every step on top of it. They were reinitialized. So all of the deep, in general, discriminative clustering models are subject to trivial solutions. If you don't do anything, and for instance, you predict the constant activation for any image, you're going to have trivial solutions. For instance, you're going to put all points in one cluster, the network is going to be predicting the same thing all over again, and you actually have minimal loss. You cluster perfectly, you predict perfectly, that's a trivial solution. So there were two important details in the algorithm. The first one was to avoid having empty clusters. So you can have implementations of k-means, where if there is an empty cluster, you create a new cluster with some images. That was actually important. And the second part was sampling point by class frequency instead of image frequency. That means that if one of your clusters is small, we're going to upsample it during the SGD training of the network, and because of that, it's going to push the boundaries away. Thanks to that, we managed to get balanced clusters at the end of the optimization. So the training data, we experimented with two things. We trained on ImageNet, which is the classical data set that everyone uses. One of the problems with that is that images are kind of naturally clustered into 1,000 categories. The second thing we trained on was Yahoo Flickr Creative Commons, where it's a data set of basically pictures from Flickr. which share some features with this, the red, maybe some of the like, vertical lines here. The same goes with planes. You're going to get airplanes. Even though you have a random network, you can still get some meaningful nearest neighbors. After the convergence, this is the kind of result that we were obtaining. We also did some visualizations by doing this kind of deep dream visualization by backpropagating. Basically, you take one neuron in your convolutional neural net, you put random noise as input, and you try to optimize the image such that this given neuron is going to be activated more. This is the kind of visualization that we were getting, which kind of are just nice visualization. There is no big claims to be made on top of that. These neurons seem to have to be dedicated to some kind of grouping of features. You have the hot air balloon neuron, the BMW neuron, the bike and spider neuron. Some of them were actually focusing on semantic objects, and some of them are actually focusing on things which are more abstract, which can be a texture or something like that. So both projects were actually released in open source. The first one with the matching between the images and the hypersphere was in Torch 7, that's the same thing mentioned at the beginning. I don't think that any one of you is going to run this thing. The second one is on GitHub, and it's in PyTorch. I think it's easier to work with. It still requires quite a lot of computational power to run. So I'm just going to conclude quickly, giving a recap. So I talked about unsupervised learning for
Which means it's like a telephone that you can take with you and talk when you're...
But it's one word.
It's one token. Yeah?
One token.
But in Mongolian case, we call it Shireni Tens with two separate words.
Okay.
In this case, we have some problems.
So that's a model. That's a very good question. I think it relates. There were already approaches before to basically how to represent the meaning of compound nouns or phrases that always appear together. And the classical solution to that is to form phrases based on basically a mutual information criteria. So you pass through the data and you realize that York almost always appears with new, and it's going to be New York. And you put a number score between the two. If the two words have high mutual information in the sense that they almost always appear together. So that's a pre-processing step that people do in order to, and yeah, that's a way of solving that problem, I guess. I'm not sure. Data collection, data obtention is usually very time consuming.